The scripture reading for today is found in John's first general epistle, chapter 2, and I shall read the first two verses. 1 John chapter 2, the first two verses. My dear children, I write this to you so that you would not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. On September 8, 1974, President Gerald Ford granted full pardon to former President Richard Nixon. From that point on, Nixon was legally forgiven. All investigations and indictments were ended. Many people in the United States got angry because they wanted the former president to be punished for his misdeeds. They got angry at President Ford for having forgiven Nixon. And as if this wasn't enough, 8 days later, President Ford granted general amnesty to all those who had illegally avoided the military draft during the Vietnam War. President Ford's acts of forgiveness became very controversial subjects in this country and exposed him to harsh criticism. And I believe this was one of the reasons why he was not re-elected, because there were citizens who did not forgive President Ford for having forgiven President Nixon and the draft dodgers. Often we are confused when it comes to forgiveness. Should we forgive everyone regardless of what they have done? The news media tries to convince us that the reason some people commit violent crimes is because they come from dysfunctional families or have abusive parents. They want us to believe that no one should be held accountable for his actions. A young woman who had suffocated her child to death got off the hook because her lawyers claimed that her family life had been very chaotic, so she was not to be blamed for her crime. The circumstances of her life made her do what she did. And so we are led to believe that no one should be blamed for their actions. And most of us have built defensive mechanisms that provide excuses for us and shield us from the guilt of our misbehavior. We are outraged when our courts allow criminals to walk away and escape justice due to legal technicality. That kind of forgiveness makes us angry because it perpetuates the problem instead of solving it. The concept of forgiveness loses its meaning if people are not held accountable for their actions. So the question that is pertinent is this: who should be forgiven? Do we have to do something to deserve forgiveness? Is forgiveness automatic or is it conditional? In 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, we read, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So if we confess our sins, if we acknowledge our misdeeds, Jesus has promised to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In some English versions it says, and Jesus, he will purify us from all unrighteousness if we confess our sins. The meaning is the same. We all want forgiveness for ourselves, but we think that others should not have it. There is a false teaching which is very misleading. It is called universalism. I don't know if you've heard of it, but the followers of this teaching say that because God is love, he cannot punish anyone. Therefore, eventually, everyone will be forgiven and everyone will be saved. This teaching is called universalism, and I believe it's not biblical. Those who preach this false teaching think that God is like a parent who doesn't have the heart to discipline his children. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 6, we read that God disciplines those whom he loves. God punished the builders of the Tower of Babel by confusing their languages because their building project was an act of defiance against his sovereign rule. God punished the wicked people of Noah's day by the great flood because all their thoughts and imaginations were evil. God punished the immoral inhabitants of the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah by fire and brimstone. So, God is not indifferent to moral evil. Therefore, God does punish people after they have consistently and persistently scorned his grace and refused to respond to his appeals in a positive way. Another false teaching that is found today is called legalism. And legalism is more or less the opposite of universalism. The followers of legalism claim that it is too difficult to be forgiven because it's hard to satisfy God. The legalists claim that you have to work hard and fulfill many requirements to please God. The legalists are experts at laying down rules for human conduct. According to the legalists, you cannot earn God's favor unless you obey a certain set of rules. They say that to please God and in order to be forgiven, you shouldn't wear jewelry of any kind, not even wedding bands. You shouldn't dance, you shouldn't go to the movies, you shouldn't drink alcohol, you shouldn't play cards, you shouldn't go to parties, and so on. The list is long. There was a time in the United States in the 19th century when the legalists said that ministers should not wear ties or Christians should not wear neckties because that's worldly. And there was a time when legalists said that all Christians should grow beards. And that women should not wear pants, or that women should not wear blouses that have open collars, or that the dresses they wear should be long enough to reach their ankles and sweep the floors. Now, we laugh at such rules. You see, the legalists have reduced the Christian life to obeying a set of rules. What God looks at is not so much what we do, but He looks at the motives that prompt our actions. Legalism leads to spiritual pride, which is the worst sin. The legalists resembled the Pharisees of New Testament times, whom Jesus condemned because they had created heavy burdens that were impossible for the people to bear. You remember in Luke chapter 18, Jesus told the story of the Pharisee who went to the temple to pray, and he assumed that he had been saved and forgiven because he had fulfilled all the legalistic requirements concerning prayer, paying tithe, helping the poor, clean living, etc. And he said this fellow was condemned. He was not justified because he did not acknowledge his sin. He did not mention one sin. He thought he was perfect. And he was praising himself and reminding God that he deserved to receive salvation as a favor because of his obedience. Now, this is salvation by works, which is condemned in the Bible, especially by the Apostle Paul. We're not saved by works, we're saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. But because we're saved, we produce good works. A good tree bears good fruit, Jesus says. So you see, universalism is wrong because God does not excuse sin, God does not wink at sin, God does not overlook sin, God does not dismiss sin as if it were nothing serious. Legalism is not true because it does not understand the true meaning of grace. The legalists don't preach about grace or seldom mention grace because they don't understand its meaning. In Isaiah 53, verse 6, the prophet says, all we like sheep have gone astray. All of us have lost our way. In Romans chapter 3, verse 23, Paul says, all of us have sinned. So there's no exception. All of us are in the same boat. All of us have lost our way. All of us are sinners, and all of us need to receive the Lord's grace. We cannot earn our salvation. Salvation is a gift given to those who accept God's offer. Forgiveness cannot be earned. We don't deserve to be forgiven. None of us deserves to be forgiven. The sinner shall die. But because God is gracious and merciful, He forgives us because we have accepted Christ's sacrifice on the cross to be a substitute for us. Christ died in our place, and He bore the full penalty of our sins. So when we place our faith in Christ, our sins are atoned for. You remember in the scripture reading, in 1 John chapter 2, verse 2, John says, Christ was the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Not only for our sins, but for the sins of the whole world. Now the whole world won't be saved because not everybody believes in Christ. But if you believe in Christ and accept his sacrifice on the cross, then God forgives you. Not because you deserve to be forgiven, just because you've placed your faith in Christ. Our sins are not excused. They are forgiven. When we confess them and when we turn to God in contrition and genuine repentance. Since today we have communion, our program is slightly changed. We don't have a